The Majority Report with Sam Cedar.
It is Wednesday, June 27th, 2018. My name is Sam Cedar. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, primaries in New York and Maryland bring huge left wins. But sadly, just as elections matter, Janus versus AFSCME resolved 5-4. The Supreme Court kneecaps public sector unions. Matt.
I feel proud of myself about that.
Supreme Court also upholds the third iteration of Donald Trump's Muslim ban.
You know, I voted for the candidate who had a Green New Deal, so.
Supreme Court has now also effectively gutted Section 3 of the Voting Rights Act.
So I say vote third party, no matter what, no matter where you are. I don't care if you're in a swing state.
Supreme Court allows anti-abortion activists to pose as crisis pregnancy centers, basically saying First Amendment for anti-abortionists, not so much for medical facilities. We did, however, have two lower federal court wins, one on Trump's policy to vanish kids of people seeking asylum, and one in Virginia on a gerrymandering case that who knows at this point whether it would be whether it matters with the Supreme Court's perspective on gerrymandering. Meanwhile, ProPublica finds more emoluments clause violations. Trump's Veterans Administration pick turns out to be a neo-Confederate. Here's some fun news. Republican tax law. Remember that one passed? Turns out it slams churches. Whoops. Always read the bill, folks.
This is the one thing we didn't want to happen.
Oh, darn it. And reality winner, who leaked information about Russia's attempts to hack into our election, gets 5 years on espionage charges. All that and more on today's program. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, lots of reason to be happy today. Also, I would say probably in terms of just material benefits, more reason to be upset. But let's start with the happy news. Because there's always the chance that this could be indicative of things to come, and also that it sends a message to Democratic lawmakers about where the future of the party lies. And I mean, there's a couple aspects of this win in New York 14th. So we should say, yeah, primaries last night in New York, in Colorado, in Maryland. I believe that's it. There may be one other state that I'm forgetting in terms of Democratic primaries. And we should say the one in New York, it was only for federal seats. The New York voting system is so effed up and such an incumbent protection racket that there are there's just a myriad of ways in which they make it difficult to vote, whether it's you need to register months and months in advance for a specific party, whether you have no sort of there's no early voting process. The absentee voting thing is rather cumbersome and difficult, all that. And this, we're going to separate the primaries. So instead of like having primaries for House and the governorship and your state reps and whatnot all on the same day. We're going to separate them by months. So that even to the point of confusion where I was like, I had forgotten that. And I, when I looked at my ballot, I'm like, wait a second. Oh, that's right. I forgot. So the biggest outcome, and or I should say the, I mean, it's a huge upset. And it is not necessarily, I mean, we saw a little bit of this. Certainly there was establishment candidates. One's backed by the Deep Triple C. One's backed by Emily's List, or ones that were not backed by Emily's List. There's clearly an energy in the base of the Democratic Party that is pushing back. And in some places it broke through, in other places it did not.
And beyond the base, right? Like people who don't usually vote.
Well, I mean, I guess it depends on how you want to define what the base of the Democratic Party is. But certainly, and I don't know the participation numbers. As far as I can tell, I mean, it's pretty, you know, there's no apples to apples version of figuring out what the primary results were in Ocasio-Cortez versus Crowley's race, because Crowley hasn't had a primary, hasn't had to run a primary, as far as I can tell, for at least for two cycles at least. And so, but the numbers seem relatively high, although they're low, right? I mean, what was it? I don't know, 30,000 people voted in a district. Maybe you had 10% of the Democrats came out. That's not extraordinary numbers. But again, that's by design. And usually that favors the incumbent, right? Because the incumbent has all the resources, and the incumbent has the ability to raise more money. And when you're talking about such low attendance primaries, low participation primaries, those type of advantages have an outsized impact. It sort of worked the opposite way in this instance, because you had really, I mean, an exceptional candidate. I mean, in general, we don't get that involved in primaries on this program. I mean, at least not for a congressional district, because there's just too many. But she's come up on the program multiple times just because she's been such a particularly outstanding candidate, whether or not she was running against the fourth most powerful Democrat and arguably the heir to the speakership of Nancy Pelosi's.
That might be the best part.
Well, in terms
there's
of
a lot of best parts, actually.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of good parts of this, and they're all going to have, you know, and how much of an implication they have. Like, look, they all could resonate. Let's start with the most tangible part. You have a 28-year-old, and she's all but sure to win the general election because of the nature of this seat. A 28-year-old activist who has amazing politics, who raised something like 70% of her dollars, and there wasn't that many, $300,000 I think she raised, was small donations, tiny donations. This versus Crowley, who got $1.5 million, five times more money than she did. And it was from some of the biggest names in the country. A year ago, she was tending bar in 2017. Less than a year ago, November, right? I mean, that's 8 months ago. And, but more important than that, she is an amazing candidate. I mean, her politics are all exceptional. She will be, I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know enough about every single member of the House. We're talking, 400 plus people. But I think she's going to be the most outspoken in terms of things like Palestinian rights. She is going to be, she won't be the first. I guess Mark Pocan has already come out with a bill to abolish ICE. But she's going to be the second or third. I mean, who knows? Hopefully by then there'll be more. But things like health care, I mean, across the board. I don't think that there's anybody who would have an issue with her politics and with her positions. Maybe some may have some. And she also is very articulate about the idea of separating race from economic issues, or separating economic issues from race. She has a very strong grasp on how those things are interrelated. And
not for nothing, she's out as a democratic socialist.
And she's out as a democratic socialist.
Which is amazing and, you know, huge for the DSA, which endorsed her.
It's
at the
huge
convention.
For the DSA. It's very helpful to folks like Zephyr Teachout and Cynthia Nixon, who endorsed her. There's a lot of implications to this.
Gillibrand's feeling that.
Yeah, I bet. And so the other issue is going to be how much of a warning shot is this? Because look, people are making comparisons between when David Bratt knocked off David Cantor and
Eric
Cantor. And the difference between that and this is, A, Eric Cantor did not think it was possible. Crowley certainly had forewarning. There's a reason why he spent $1.5 million. He saw this coming, and he could not stop it. In addition to that, and Brendan had made this point earlier, there's, I think, been one incumbent who has lost their election in terms of Democrats since 2016. In terms of Republicans, this happens a lot. There is, you just don't see this on the Democratic side. And so, and we had another race, can't remember what district it was in New York off the top of my head, where we had another incumbent who nearly lost, I think, to first-generation refugee. But she seems to have pulled it out.
Yeah, in the ninth against, that's my district, against Bunk. I can't pronounce his last
right.
name. But yeah, she was close too. And I voted for him. He turns out to be like a charter schools guy too. But
so there's definitely a movement afoot. And this is going to provide both inspiration for activists on the ground that they can do something like this. It's also going to cause the Democratic caucus to move to the left. And it leaves a vacuum in the leadership. And necessarily, every time you knock off, and we were talking about this the other day, not in the context of this race, but I think this is really indicative of it. The baby boomers sucked up all the oxygen, if you will, all the potential, nutrients that it takes to grow a political leadership from folks in the generations that followed them. I don't think it's a coincidence that this is a 28-year-old who won, who is part of a generation that is like literally larger than the largest generation since the baby boomers. And I think in addition to, and we mentioned this, I think, in the context of PAYGO, the Democratic leadership, and I've had positive things to say about Nancy Pelosi, but I think it's quite clear that the combination of always being a bubble when you're in leadership. That's there's a certain inevitability about that after a certain period of time. But also being older and having lessons and lessons formed from your formative years that are really outdated. The Democratic leadership is sclerotic. And anything that can sort of start to break that up a little bit. Because when they look for a replacement for Crowley, it's probably going to come from a younger generation. And just the idea that you're breaking that up, even if it's from someone who isn't necessarily from the more progressive wing of the Democratic Party, and I think that's it's possible that it could be. If they're smart, they will.
Or people who aren't Democrats and they're staging a hostile takeover of the Democratic Party.
Well, they're unlikely to get into the leadership of the Democratic Party.
You never know.
Well, okay. I mean, I don't know how that works out. But I'm saying people in Congress who are Democrats are going to try and get into leadership to fill that void. I mean, this is just the reality of it. Hopefully it starts to break that up. Because my concern is not just even issue sets. I think there's a real problem with just sort of being able to do politics in a sort of just the mechanics of it. Chuck Schumer has shown himself to be incredibly ineffectual in bringing about outcomes that I think are uncontroversial across the spectrum of ideologies in the Democratic Party. And that's the worst case scenario. I mean, at the very least, you want a partisan to be able to bring about partisan outcomes. All right, but let's look at some video of
Ocasio-Cortez that I just got in.
Sure.
As per a tweet from Ocasio-Cortez, the turnout was previously 3%, but I'm seeing reports from my DSA folks that it was 13% this time around.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to know. It's not really apples and apples. If he's the only person running, 3% makes sense. But it's hard. You'd have to find some other similarly situated race. But nevertheless, it is a good thing that you have 10% more people coming out.
Yeah.
Or I should say 10 percentage points more getting involved. Before we go there. Learning a new language, it's a journey, folks. It can be difficult, but it's one of the most rewarding experiences a person can have. The best way to reach your goal, whether it's a basic understanding or full-on fluency, immersion. Immerse yourself in the language. Now there is a way, finally, to do that online from the comfort of your own home, thanks to LiveLingua. LiveLingua offers immersive online language lessons via Skype. They don't offer some trendy new gimmick. 5 minutes a day is not going to make you fluent in a month, no matter what anyone says. But if you're looking to learn one of the 11 most commonly spoken languages, you need a proven approach to become fluent and confident, and LiveLingua has it. They follow the immersive language learning method that diplomats and educators have used for hundreds of years, but they do it online, giving students the opportunity to build a routine and a comfort zone that works for them. On Skype, students work one-on-one with their teacher. Their instructors are all native speakers of the language, meaning there is no intimidation or worry of falling behind because you're not looking at that guy or that girl in the class who, you know, comes in and somehow, like, I don't know, they speak with a fancy accent. Sometimes it makes you feel intimidated. I'm not speaking in person. Their immersive method increases memorization, finally helps a new language be part of your life. Listeners of the Majority Report can check out LiveLingua's platform right now. You can sign up for a free trial lesson today at LiveLingua.com/majority. LiveLingua's immersive language method is convenient, productive, and built to meet the needs of each student. Visit LiveLingua.com/majority to sign up for your free lesson. All right, let's hear some audio from Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. This is the clip of her finding out that she won. And I think, you know, she just looks pretty stunned. We also have video that I want to play a little bit later, which shows just how adept of a candidate she is. But let's watch this first in terms of appreciating the energy that this is bringing to the Democratic Party.
She's right here. I can't let you. She's looking at herself on television right now. How are you feeling?
Pause it for 1 second. Understand, she's not just looking at herself on television. She's looking at the fact that she beat Joe Crowley by something like 15 points. I mean, this was a whooping. A whooping.
She's right here. I can't let you. She's looking at herself on television right now. How are you feeling? Can you put it into words?
No. Nope. I cannot put this into words.
All right, you're excited for you. This is a grassroots campaign. Can you believe the numbers that you're seeing right now?
I cannot believe these numbers right now, but I do know that every single person here has worked their butt off to change the future of the broken pain. That's what I know. That's what I know. And that this victory belongs to every single grassroots organizer, every working parent, every mom, every member of the LGBTQ community. Every single person is responsible for this.
Hell yeah.
I mean, that's, you know, talk about expositional, you know, sort of on message and enthusiastic. That's pretty amazing.
I'm going to say it again. Hell yeah.
Very exciting stuff. And let's see, did this print out? I had a printout of her. Oh, yeah, here it is. Here is her platform as she was handing out. Medicare for all, medicine, vision, dental, mental health care, universal jobs guarantee, serve our communities with living wages, fully funded public schools and universities, plus taxing Wall Street to support tuition-free public universities and trade schools, paid family and sick leave, housing as a human right, safe, secure, habitable, and affordable homes, justice system reform, and the war on drugs, demilitarize police, abolish for-profit incarceration, immigration justice, protect dreamers and TPS recipients. That's the those folks we have now deported who were here in the like the event like the Haitian earthquake or a civil war. Simplify the paths to citizenship and abolish ICE. Infrastructure overhaul. Invest 100% renewable green industry. Clean campaign finance, ending the corrupting influence of corporate finance and public elections, an economy of peace that supports our veterans, actively values all humanity. That was her printed platform that she was handing out to folks. And here is, and I just want to, like, Sean McKelvey, who we would never platform on the show, I say just to... but I think I am speaking to him for, on Ring of Fire this week, but he has made the case, quite a bit, often, through data and, applying people with alcohol that the key to, folks with good stances on issues to winning is, across the country is also that they be good candidates. And being a good candidate involves a whole set of skills and also, frankly, a profile that is going to drive people to the polls. A Latina woman is in a district that it has a growing or a significant Latina population, and a young woman in a district that has growing numbers of young people. Demographically, people should, it makes sense that people are going to want to elect people who reflect themselves. That happens all the time. That is why the Republican Party votes exclusively for white people almost 90 some odd time, because they're only made up of white people, the party. And so, she is a perfect example of someone with great politics and also being an amazing candidate. And the perfect example of that is she is interviewed by Poppy Harlow, on CNN. I don't know anything about Poppy Harlow. But it was a classic one of those, let's get the freak on, right, and expose them. And I have to say that, like, you know, it's the Poppy Harlow wasn't, like, extremely hostile. But she was clearly gunning for something. And
there's a condescension there, too.
Definitely. And of a growing frustration because she can't, she's be all of her attempts to sort of pigeonhole her or to caricature Ocasio-Cortez fall apart. Let's start with this one where Poppy Harlow is talking about, is asking her about ICE.
So you have called for a number of things, one of them being to abolish ICE. And you recently traveled to the border to Tornillo, Texas, to see the shelters, to see where some of these separated families are being held. What would you replace ICE with? And do we not need protection at the border?
Well, we absolutely do need to make sure that our borders are secure, to make sure that people are safe in passage. But what we need to realize and remember is that ICE was established in 2003, right at the same time as the Patriot Act, the AUMF, the Iraq War. And we look back at a lot of that time and legislation as a mistake now. And I think that ICE is right there as a part of it. It has its extrajudicial nature is baked in to the structure of the agency, and that is why they're able to get away with black sites at our border, with the separation of children. We are committing human rights abuses on this border and separating children from their families, and that is part of the structure of the agency. We can replace it, and we can replace it with a humane agency that is directed towards safe passage instead of the direction of a criminalization.
What do you mean black sites? What do you mean about black ICE black sites?
So I was just, yes. So actually we were just hopping off MSNBC and they were talking about it. Basically what we have is that people are not able to access, even our own members of Congress are not able to access what is happening in these sites. Mm-hmm. And that in and of itself, the secretive nature, and when we know that children are being kept and that human rights abuses are happening in without any sort of transparency or accountability, that is where we're at right now. That is simply what is happening.
I would note those facilities run by HHS, but I know some of the lawmakers who've even gotten inside have not been able to see some of the children.
So there you have it. I mean, and Poppy Harlow's producer goes, well, they're run by HHS. I mean, Poppy Harlow learned a lot, I think, in that segment from her. I don't think she realized that ICE was a relatively new agency. I don't think she was aware that you could characterize these as black sites because of their secretive nature. And so I think Poppy Harlow learned a lot in that moment. And she may have been convinced, but she still needs to find something that that will make her seem like she's a lunatic. Let's go to clip number three.
Red baiting.
Do you see yourself, Alexandria, as more of a Democrat?
Wait, this is clip number three, right?
Pelosi. There are some Democrats, as you know, who have been pushing for impeachment proceedings against the president should Democrats retake the House in November. There are other Democrats, like Representative Jerry Nadler of New York as well, who have warned against that and said that is a dangerous path for Democrats to run on. Where do you fall? Would you push for a Trump impeachment should you win?
Well, I would support impeachment. I think that we have the grounds to do it. I think what really we need to focus on is making sure that we are advocating for the policies to win in November. But ultimately, I think that what we need to kind of focus on is ensuring that we can, when people break the law, potentially break the law, that we have to hold everyone accountable and that no person is above that law.
And which is an incredible, I mean, and I think she will refine those comments to that. And she sort of found that over the course of just that addressing that question, understanding that This is going to be used as some type of bludgeon against her. But who can argue with the idea that, like, if someone's broken the law, we have to make sure that no one is above the law. This is where Poppy Harlow is really trying to sow division, right? Like, oh, this is going to be a real problem for the Democrats. We're going to be able to set this baby up as a Bernie bro versus Hillary type of situation. But nope.
Such a bro.
Do you see yourself, Alexandria, as more of a Democrat or progressive? Would you say I am a member of the Democratic Party this morning?
I'm proud to be a Democrat. I was raised in a Democratic family with Democratic values. But it also means that the Democratic Party is a big tent, and there are so many ways to be a Democrat. And I'm proud to bring to Congress an additional perspective and a lens towards what the future of the Democratic Party may be.
In 2020, should you win in November? In 2020,
I mean, how bummed is Poppy Harlow in that moment, right? I mean, like, are you a Democrat or are you an ideology? Like you know, like the idea, like that's well, not even.
It's a very revealing question, though.
Well, it's revealing of Poppy Harlow.
I don't know, man.
Well,
I mean,
no,
I'll let you finish the video before I say what I want to say about it.
Well, okay, good, but. The fact is that people have been identifying themselves as a progressive Democrat there's literally a progressive caucus in the Democratic Party, the biggest caucus that exists. So the idea that you can't be a progressive and a Democrat simultaneously is beyond fiction. But she wants to set it up that way as if you can't be both of those things simultaneously. And so Poppy Harlow loses, but let's let this continue.
In 2020, should you win in November, in 2020, can you say right now that you will unequivocally back the Democratic nominee in opposition to President Trump? Meaning, you know, if this were 2016, would it be a guarantee that Hillary Clinton would
have gotten your- Look at it. Before Harlow can even finish her question, right? Like, ask the question, will you support the Democratic nominee? Yeah. Wait, I want to give the other scenario, which I'm trying to bait you into. And she's already answered the question. But Harlow has such an agenda here that she has to continue on. Go ahead. Go back just a little bit.
2016, would it be a guarantee that Hillary Clinton would have gotten your vote?
Yeah.
Or do you foresee a reasonable scenario?
She did it again. She did it again.
No, I mean, I think that we're just at a moment where we absolutely have to support the Democratic nominee against President Trump, absolutely, without question.
Darn.
Okay, I mean, a better question to ask might be, can you be a Democrat and a socialist? And I don't know. Like,
I don't
know
either.
The Democratic Party is a capitalist political party. Socialists want to end capitalism. She says that she's a socialist. Like, there's a pretty good interview.
All right, well, wait a second.
Wait a second.
Let's just stay on topic here with what this interview was. If you want to talk about whether or not she's a legit socialist, we can do that in another, you know, in a minute.
No, I think she
is. But let me finish this. The bottom line is that there is an attempt by Harlow here to create a narrative that is just not working. And what this is showing is that Ocasio-Cortez is an incredibly adept politician. She knows how the media wants to pigeonhole her. She knows how the media wants to caricature her. And it is not, she is, and this is on day one. She is destroying Harlow's attempt. Let's see, here is, but at the same time is not having to move an inch off of where she is on these positions. She hasn't had to back off a single position that she has. Let's do this last one.
If I be elected to Congress in November, I will accomplish blank.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I think should I be elected to Congress in November, I'm hoping to
to accomplish not just my own election, but a caucus of progressives in the primaries to come, so that we can kind of come in to this legislation and, I mean, come into Congress and be able to co-sponsor really a profound legislation that not only fights for economic, social, and racial dignity for all Americans, but advances health care as a human right, advances higher education, the expansion of higher education, including trade school to all working class Americans and more.
All right, and the name that is top of mind for you when it comes to the Democrat you think should run against President Trump in 2020, I want one name. What is it?
Oh, man, I do not have one right now. There are a lot of great ones.
That's a problem. That's a problem for your party, isn't it, that you don't have a name?
Pause it. Like, did she say how desperate she is here to come up with a problem? It's a problem that you don't have a name. First off, in what possible scenario, what is she saying is a problem? We had 2 years out, certainly a definitive nominee in 2014.
Hillary.
Right? Exactly. And that didn't work out so well. So, like, on what basis is it a problem that someone who has just won a Democratic primary can't come up with a specific nominee they want to support? Go ahead.
Right now, there are a lot of great ones.
That's a problem. That's a problem for your party, isn't it, that you don't have a name?
I mean, I think healthy competition. We're used to voting for the lesser of two evils instead of the better of two options. And I hope that in the future, you know, in 2020, we realize that having more than one amazing candidate is not a problem.
Is there a better option? I mean, not a lesser of two evils. I mean, if you think of a Kamala Harris and Elizabeth Warren, a Kirsten Gillibrand, or any of those names top for you right now, do you think they can and should win against President Trump?
For me, I think that any candidate right now in 2020, my first bar is the rejection of corporate lobbyist PAC money.
I mean, she's so on top of this stuff. It's really incredible. Her ability to handle these questions, which were all aimed at promoting a specific narrative, failed because she was so adept. And she's 28. I mean, at one point, she's going to be 38, and it'll be, we are literally looking at the future of the party, I think, in Ocasio-Cortez.
One thing that you see in watching enough cable news over the past few years is there is all these chapters of these anchors not realizing or being adept in dealing with these new people that come on the scene, whether it's these Trump people who just espouse fake news all the time and just shut them down, or now with the left just being more educated and knowing their points better than the people that they're talking to.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like there have been times where I have seen interviews with folks on the left where they'll get tripped up in this stuff. And she, I just thought, was incredibly adept at dealing with that. And it doesn't, I don't think it gets more sort of like earnestly aggressive than that. She could go on Fox, I guess, but it would be disingenuous. This was like a real agenda, down to the point of like, I mean, but this is a big problem. You don't, we're 2.5 years out and you don't have a candidate that you're supporting for president yet, of non-declared candidates.
I can't get over that. There's an impression that the left really doesn't want to see Trump impeached or something. And like, I feel like that's like that Poppy Harlow was trying to play on with that question. But like, I feel like people just don't want it to be the priority.
Which is exactly what she said.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, what Harlow was doing was desperately trying to basically throw her hook into a bunch of like little pools. And the hooks, you know, are these narratives that it's impressive to see Ocasio-Cortez knock these down, because it means that she's not afraid to go into these different pools. And a lot of Democrats are afraid. You know, there's a lot of Democrats who avoid going on television because they can't deal with stuff.
Well, it is a very hard line to walk. And I think that Poppy was speaking to a real division that exists within the Democratic Party and between the Democratic Party and the people who are trying to take it over from the left. And I saw her speak. I saw Ocasio-Cortez speak at the DSA convention, the New York City-wide convention, and I was very impressed with her. I mean, you know, she might have been tailoring her speech for her audience, but she talked about democratizing the economy. She's done interviews like this great one in Vogue where she said socialism is, you know, democratic participation in our economy, our economic, social, and racial dignity, and the only way people have to lead a dignified life. And I voted to endorse her. She did not identify strongly as a Democrat, but obviously she's not going to come on national TV and say the Democrats suck, I'm taking you over to enact leftist policies. But like, this is really a tricky thing that we're trying to do right now from the left. And there are structural limitations in terms of how much reform the Democratic Party can make. Certainly, like the sort of non-reformist reforms she's talking about, like a job guarantee and like pretty radical for our current environment kinds of things. So like, at least for me, my vote to endorse her was, it was coming from a socialist horizon, and it'll be interesting to see how people handle this. Like, I think she's doing a really good job. But like, the Democrats are a failed brand. Socialism is a rising brand, and, yeah, we're doing it through the Democratic Party right now because we have to. We have a two-party system. Like, it's going to be a long time before we have a viable socialist party in America. But that's something to keep an eye on.
I mean, I thought of, like, Henry Giroux in the interview yesterday when he talks about how you need to have one foot in and one foot out and how you basically can't leave any of these places uncontested. And I think, yeah, like we don't know theoretically what can be accomplished or what the limitations are, but we do know for a fact that a democratic socialist can beat a very powerful machine Democrat in a primary. And, you know, what that leads to or not is something we have to find out through, I think, like Giroux said, again, a dialectical process. Like, we're going to find this stuff out. And I think, frankly, I think a lot of people wouldn't have expected her to even have a chance, and that she's done this, I think, should inform people going forward.
Oh yeah, and I think the party establishment is really scared right now, because like she's taking a very she's going to be threatening no matter what, but she's taking a very non-threatening approach, at least in that interview, which I think is probably the right move. But
absolutely,
when you say that it's a big tent, like you can only grow a tent so far in one direction before it has to shrink in another. And
you mean it's a zero-sum game?
I don't know if I'd put it that way exactly, but some of the stuff she's talking about is stuff that socialists want in service of a much more radical horizon. So it makes sense that some, you know, centrists who are committed to defending the status quo would feel very threatened by her and very angry. So
I actually think there's an interesting discussion about like the Yvette Clark race, because if you think of because she was the incumbent and she barely beat a Bunkadetto. And if you think you can basically change two different parts of that race to make whichever case you want, which is like if Yvette Clark was an old white guy, maybe Bunkadetto wins. But also if Bunkadetto had like DSA support, maybe he wins too.
Right. I think there's a lot of different things. It's really important, I think, for folks to not presume that there's any one thing that accounts for someone winning or losing in these elections. And that is the important thing, I think, to keep in mind. Ocasio-Cortez, and the reason why I played that last series of clips was to show that you have an incredibly adept politician, and with a lot of incredible skills. She also has in her favor a demographic profile in terms of youth, in terms of gender, and in terms of ethnicity that is suited to that district, which is also really important. And on top of that, she has issues set that is energizing people. And on top of that,
and energizing working class people, right?
And activists,
like this shows that
door knockers.
You can speak to working class people. You can speak to poor people. No politicians like to talk about poor people, but
yes, I mean, I don't know who those 14,000 people were that came out and voted for her. I don't know.
I don't think they were iBankers.
Well, I mean, look, we're talking about the Bronx and Queens. I don't think there's necessarily a huge group of bankers who were voting for Crowley. They may have been funding him, and his partner may have been running a foreclosure mill, but they weren't actually going out and pulling the lever. So I don't know, but I mean, presumably, I mean, she's energizing people in terms of issue sets. And so all of those things together make a difference. Any one of those elements falls out, maybe she doesn't win, or maybe she wins by a smaller margin. You take any one of those elements maybe and give them to somebody else, and maybe that person wins. I mean, so this is, it's important to understand and try and assess what's going on in a win like that. Then you move on to the next order of business, which is to project out and how projecting what that win means is going to affect the party. And I think it's going to have a big impact on the party, particularly if one more of these happens.
Because it's at least demonstrating that these sort of economic issue sets aren't a liability in any
exactly.
Extent.
Yeah, and if this can happen in an establishment Democrat stronghold like New York, it can happen anywhere.
Yes, yes. But we have examples of it not happening in this, you know, in Colorado. A Medicare for All supporter lost to some self-funder. That guy who had videotaped Steny Hoyer telling him he was on the outs. I can't remember. It didn't win.
Well, these kinds of politics only just recently entered the mainstream of electoralism in America.
I agree. I mean, we have proof, 4 miles from us, that maybe seven, maybe eight, I guess.
Yeah, nine. And it's a result of grassroots movements. Like, I'm an electoral skeptic, but the right way to do it is definitely as an outgrowth of grassroots movements by working class people in favor of, you know, all the stuff that we like. So I think she's doing great. I think Julia Salazar from my area, North Brooklyn, has a pretty good chance of winning as well in the state Senate election.
It'd be nice if their elections were on the primaries were on the same day.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no shit. I saw the tweets about Ocasio-Cortez. I was like, oh shit, is it time to vote for Julia already?
Right.
No, it's not.
Also, another big win in Maryland. Bangelis, former NAACP president, won the Democratic nomination for governor on Tuesday, which is going to be a much harder election in the general in the fall. Larry Hogan, the Republican, is well liked apparently in Maryland, but who knows? But it's a very good sign that that Jealous won that primary. I mean, those are the big highlights, and I we're running a little bit short on time here, but I want to just go through some of these Supreme Court cases. Maybe we'll have somebody on tomorrow, because there's a rash of them. But the bottom line, whether it is the upholding of the Muslim ban, whether it is the Texas racial gerrymandering case in the North Carolina racial gerrymandering case, but particularly the Texas one, which in many respects guts the third section of the Voting Rights Act, whether it is the case where anti-abortion activists can pose as crisis pregnancy centers and there can be no laws restricting the so-called health clinics as to what they must inform their patients of, versus every single law that's been upheld by the Supreme Court, what actual medical facilities must do in terms of abortion. I mean, the key here is that the court is completely compromised in terms of following any type of, and of course, Janus as well, which we will talk about, which hopefully, if any of you have been listening to this program for any length of time, know all the facts about. But it is essentially one where it would have been like the Friedrich case that was saved by the death of Antonin Scalia, where public sector workers who are working in unionized shops, very briefly, municipalities, counties, states, want to deal with a union because they have so many employees, it is much harder to negotiate with each individual employee. And they want to do their negotiations with one representative. That is the union. So everyone in who gets these jobs have a responsibility not to pay the union dues that may go into political activities, but unions require an agency fee. In other words, we do the negotiating for you. We get you a raise. We get you a pension. We get you working conditions. But we got to pay lawyers to do that. We've got to maintain some type of process to see if the employee's violating that. You got to pay for that. That's an agency fee. The Supreme Court has now said agency fees must be voluntary. And even joining a union, there is a high bar opt-in. So this is essentially, I want to say an attempt, but it is a kneecap of the unions. There and maybe we've got to have two guests tomorrow. It's a kneecap of the unions. That doesn't mean that the unions can't step back, reorganize, re-strategize. They've been doing this. They've seen this coming down the pike for a while. Part of what we saw in these half a dozen red states with teachers there who are living in a similar situation as like a post-Janus world, we've seen the a vision, perhaps, of what unions must do. But remember, with teachers, it is my opinion, anyways, that teachers have an advantage. They have much more of an opportunity to do this type of stuff than, let's say, a sanitation worker or a public works worker or even an MTA worker, because teachers have already a pre-existing channel to the community, and one which is not a push thing. It's more of like a pull, right? Like parents gravitate towards teachers. Teachers don't have to... it's easier for teachers to get out into the community because they're already sort of brought out into the community because of their daily connection to the people living around them. Sanitation worker, they're not meeting people at the curb and saying, oh, here's your bag. Hey, Bill. Hey, Betty. Thanks for the bag of trash. And so... This ruling is going to be have incredible implications, and understand what it's going to do electorally. I mean, all of these rulings today from the Supreme Court, in some version or another, are not just ideological; they are also very political. They are also very partisan political. There's been a lot of data that shows that when you have these type of so-called right-to-work laws in states, votes for Democrats drop by a couple of percentage points. Certainly, when you have racist, gerrymandered Texas districts, and this is not my assessment, this is the assessment of the lower court, and even the Supreme Court did not rule that these districts are not racist. Just that it was inappropriate to call them racist. We can't adjudicate this. And I'll go through what I'm talking about more specifically, but we're talking about districts that were drawn in 2010-11, essentially. A court found that they were drawn in a racist manner. There was no time to fix them. The legislature essentially adopted most of these districts in 2013 for the 2014 elections, the 2012 elections. A court found subsequent to that, like, yeah, no, these are more or less the same districts, so they're still racist. And the Supreme Court said, well, since the legislature's, you know, you have to give them a presumption that they're not making racist districts. So this has to go back and you have to reprove, essentially, these same districts are racist. That's going to have massive implications on not just the 2018 elections, but the 2020 elections. And that's a census time. And that's where they're going to be redistricting again. These crisis pregnancy centers is just simply a gift to anti-abortion activists. This is basically, you know, this is down payment. We will talk about it. But these rulings are, they're a joke. They're simply a joke. And the only good news from the White House, and I say this with just a modicum of trepidation, because it's possible. It's, you know, anything is possible. But if Kennedy was going to retire, he would have announced it today. It would have been announced today at the end of the term. And it would have given McConnell time to push through a nominee. It is widely believed that we would know as of today if Kennedy was going to retire, and it appears that he's not. A lot of people were very concerned about this because there's been a lot of rumors and, you know, people reading tea leaves and whatnot. Still possible. And we're, you know, I should remind you, we're talking about an 80-some-odd-year-old man, and he was not helpful this term. Last term, he was a little bit more helpful. This term, not so much. The big things that we were waiting on were these gerrymandering cases. I mean, they've been waiting on for 10 years. And Kennedy had been waiting in these gerrymandering cases for some way. He had called almost publicly for some mechanism in which to determine what it means to be unfairly gerrymandered. And so social scientists went out, mathematicians went out, and they came up with a formula that nobody seems to dispute. It's just they still punted. So elections have consequences. And if you think the judiciary is not important, then in terms of American politics, the short version of what I'm going to say is you're an idiot. The longer version is go ask people in Texas or North Carolina, or go ask people who are seeking an abortion and end up in a fake pregnancy center, or go ask people who are banned from this country because essentially because they're Muslim, or go ask members of unions as their pensions and wages will drop in the coming years. And frankly, the wages of everyone around them. And that's just today.
I don't disagree with anything you just said, but like given the circumstances that we have now, like what are we supposed to do? Like, we can't vote out Supreme Court justices. So I think everybody needs to
have a memory, retain this information for 2020. So when someone tells you it doesn't, the courts don't matter, understand they don't know what they're talking about. Ask Mitch McConnell if the courts matter. His whole career is culminating in packing the federal judiciary and in keeping that one seat open. so that Donald Trump could fill it. And maybe have Donald Trump fill another empty seat. That's what I'm saying. Is there any action for you to take right this moment? Yes. Go tell somebody else that the courts matter.
Oh, come on. We have to do more than that.
Well, I'm in terms of the courts.
In terms of these decisions and their impact, like
I think they're specific to the decisions. Like, you know, the unions have to adjust and adapt and figure out what they can do to make people, you know, to explain to them the value and that. Is involved in them paying these agency fees or their dues. In terms of like the Muslim ban, I'm not sure what can happen specifically in that arena.
Well, and we've been seeing it, right? Like we just covered it on the show 2 days ago and perhaps yesterday, people are occupying the ICE locations. They're shouting people out of restaurants.
Yes,
they're doing
absolutely everything they can.
You can
mitigate. We're sheltering families and churches. Like, we don't just have to roll over and accept
things. I'm not suggesting that at all. I'm not suggesting that at all. I can say people need to remember that courts are important is not my way of saying you should do nothing until 2020 and vote. I mean, I'm hoping people don't think just because I'm talking specifically about the implications of court decisions that I'm somehow saying you shouldn't be active and not continue to protest and whatnot. And let me also make clear, when we're talking about people protesting Mitch McConnell or, occupying, an ICE facility in Portland, I'm not then also saying that courts don't matter. It goes both ways.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
You just sounded a little depressing and fatalistic for a second.
It's depressing. I mean, it is depressing because the idea that, it's depressing because I've spent over 10 years trying to argue that courts matter. And there were a lot of louder voices saying that courts don't matter.
I don't know who you could possibly be talking about.
I'd say vote third party, no matter what, no matter where you are. I don't care if you're in a swing state.
Yeah, no, I do not agree with that, obviously.
Thank you.
But like, I think it's going to unleash a whole lot of stuff right now. Like the Janus decision, we talked about this in reference to the teacher strike, the teacher strikes all over the country. Like unions have historically been a compromise between labor and capital. And, that compromise has been eroding so much that capital doesn't think they need to hold up their end of the bargain anymore. The GOP thinks that they can just make these laws and unions will roll over and die. But guess what, people? That's not going to happen.
Well, no. And
people have the power to withhold their labor.
Yep.
And they have the power to extract concessions from Republican controlled legislatures. And they're going to do that a whole lot more after the Janus decision.
I hope so. Long
term, they're going to rue the day.
I hope you're right. All right. We're going to take a quick break, head into the fun half. Just a reminder, this show relies on your support to continue. You can become a member at jointhemajorityreport.com. Jointhemajorityreport.com. And when you become a member, we say thank you by giving you extra content every day. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY. Get 10% off. A reminder, you can hear Jamie's podcast, The Antifada, via Patreon at patreon.com/TheAntifada. This week.
So I just dropped part two of our episode with Justin Charles of the DSA Afro-Socialist and Socialists of Color Caucus. That is for patrons. It's a special little treat for y'all. And we also drag on Elon Musk a little bit. And also later today...
I must admit that for Patreon.
Later today, we're releasing our special crossover episode with Brett of Rev Left Radio, and I'm really excited for everyone to hear it.
Crossovers. And this week, Matt?
Nothing new from Literary Hangover this week. First, if you want to watch it on YouTube, it's Literary Hangover has a YouTube channel now.
All right, folks, quick break. Head into the fun half, 646-257. Oh, let me also say this. right now, our Google app is not in the App Store. Our Android app, it will be returned shortly. So if you've been looking for that and wondering why you can't find it via majorityapp.com, give it a day or two, and I think they're going to reinstate it. There was some questionnaire we were supposed to fill out, and we didn't do it. I'm sorry. All right, 646-257-3920, back in a minute.